Hello, my name is Brad Goodfellow. I'm a geologist at SGU, and today you'll be learning about beach morphodynamics. This presentation runs for about 15 minutes and consists of 14 slides. You will learn basic knowledge of wave generation and wave breaking on beaches. You'll also learn what happens to water and beach sediment after wave breaking, which forms the basis of beach morphodynamics. Learning these basics will allow you to interpret beaches and identify safe places for swimming. Throughout this vignette, we will use illustrations selected from around the globe, but also maintain a focus on the beaches of southern Sweden. But firstly, what is a beach? A beach is an accumulation of sediment deposited by waves along a sea or lake shore. We most commonly think of beaches as comprised of sand, but they can also be comprised of larger sized sediments, such as gravel and cobbles. In southern Sweden, we find a range of beaches, including sand, mixed sand and gravel, and cobbles. These sediments were left behind by the last ice sheet around 17,000 years ago, and have been reworked by waves, water currents, and wind. Finer sediments, including silt and clay, do not form beaches because breaking waves provide an environment too energetic for these small particles to settle. Rather, these fine particles accumulate in shelter locations such as estuaries. A general rule is the larger the grain size, the steeper the beach. This is our first key take-home point. The effect of sediment size on beach steepness is illustrated in this photograph, showing a steep beach face developed in cobbles, meeting a flat sandy terrace at its base. Why do waves form? Waves form from wind blowing across sea and lake surfaces. The longer the distance over which the wind blows, the stronger the wind, and the longer the duration of blowing wind, the larger the waves. We can use this information to make a prediction from our wave portal over which of Skagerrak or Öresund will the largest waves form. The largest waves form in the Skagerrak because of the much larger distances of water over which winds, particularly from the southwest, can blow. We can see this effect by comparing data from two points, one located in Skagerrak and one in Öresund. These data are presented as cumulative frequency plots, where wave height is represented on the x-axis and the cumulative frequency from 0 to 100% is presented on the y-axis. For the Skagerrak wave model point, we can see that waves up to 50 centimeters high occur only 50% of the time, whereas for the Öresund point, they occur 88% of the time. This brings us to our second key take-home point. The Baltic Sea coastline is generally low energy, but changes to an intermediate energy environment during windstorms. It is rarely, if ever, a high energy environment, whereas some oceanic beaches mostly occur in a high energy state. Why do waves break? Storm winds generate waves with many different wavelengths and frequencies. Once waves leave the generation area, they sort themselves out into dominant wavelengths and frequencies because it is more efficient for the energy that has been imparted from the wind to the water to travel that way. Waves can then travel hundreds or even thousands of kilometers. However, once they approach a shoreline, they have to release or dissipate that energy, which they do through breaking. This happens because waves change shape in shallow water. The troughs become flatter and the crests steepen. Because wave energy travels faster in deeper water, the wave crest travels faster than the trough. The wave becomes unstable and falls over itself. This is breaking. This brings us to our third key take-home point. Waves break in shallow water. This means that they break as they approach coastlines and at a more detailed scale over sandbars. The effect of waves breaking in shallow water at coastlines, including over sandbars, is illustrated in these two photographs. We will now investigate two key questions related to wave breaking. What happens to the water and what happens to the sediment? Firstly, with respect to water. Breaking waves drive water shorewards and onto the beach. That water has to return to the sea, and there are three potential pathways for that. Firstly, some water drains through the beach sediment and returns as shallow groundwater. However, most of the water drains back over the beach and seabed. On high energy beaches, bed return flow dominates, which leads to a vertical segregation between onshore flowing water at the top of the water column and seawards returning water at the bottom. Another commonly used but misleading term for bed return flow is undertow, which has a somewhat sinister overtone. You can however ignore undertow because there is no such thing. In contrast to the vertical segregation of flow on high energy beaches, on intermediate energy beaches, the onshore and offshore flow of water is laterally segregated. Along some parts of the beach, waves push water shorewards, on other parts narrow currents form, which transport water seaward. These currents are termed rip currents, and they pose a significant swimming risk because they transport water and people offshore and then seawards of the wave breaking zone. This lateral segregation between onshore and offshore flowing water is commonly observed on beaches, as we can see in this image. The key message from this slide is that bed return flow dominates on high energy beaches, whereas rip currents dominate on intermediate energy beaches. Moving water also transports sediment, so water being driven shorewards by waves can build beaches, whereas water flowing offshore as bed return flow or in rip currents erodes sediment from beaches and transports it offshore. The effects of this sediment transport on beach morphologies are often visible in the case of rip currents, because by transporting sediment offshore, rip currents often erode embayments into the beach and carve out channels, which appear as narrow zones of darker, deeper water. So the key message here is that beach morphologies reflect the balance in net onshore sediment transport by waves and offshore and alongshore sediment transport by currents. We now know that beach morphologies are generated through sediment transport by waves and currents. However, morphologies in turn control where waves break and where currents flow. For example, once a rip channel has formed, then the rip current can persist in that location until there is a change in wave energy. A great example of morphologic control on wave breaking is provided by sandbars. Because waves preferentially break in shallow water, wave breaking tends to focus over sandbars. The control provided by waves and currents on beach morphologies and the control in turn exerted by morphologies on hydrodynamics is the essence of beach morphodynamics. This now brings us to the key part of this big net. From our basic understanding of beach morphodynamics, we can make the following generalizations. Dissipative beaches form under high wave energies. Fine sand also contributes to dissipative beach formation. Dissipative beaches are so named because they dissipate the high wave energies through wave breaking over broad, low gradient beaches. Because wave energies are high, the waves break and reform multiple times before the wave energy is dissipated. Because waves preferentially break in shallow water, breaking occurs over offshore sandbars and over the broad, gently sloping beaches. Because bed return flow is the dominant mechanism for the seaward's return of water, offshore sandbars tend to be long and linear and beaches are uniformly near planar. Intermediate beaches form under intermediate wave energies. Medium grain sand may also contribute to their formation. Because the seaward's return of water occurs through rip currents, intermediate beaches display complex morphologies. Sandbars are present, but display varying shapes through having been dissected by rip currents rather than being linear, and the beach face tends to display embayments rather than being uniformly near planar. Intermediate beaches form along southern Sweden during stormy high wind days, particularly in winter. This is because storm waves are more energetic than the waves that generally occur. Stronger wave breaking during storms and resulting stronger currents erode sediment from beaches and transport it offshore to form sandbars. But then something really interesting happens. Because waves preferentially break in shallow water, wave breaking is enhanced at the locations of the sandbars, which helps to dissipate storm wave energy before it reaches the shoreline. This then means that erosion of beaches to form offshore sandbars protects the beach from further erosion. This is a great example in nature of a negative feedback loop. Upon a return to the lower energy waves, the sediment will generally tend to migrate from the sandbar back onto the beach. So, beach erosion is not always a problem. It becomes a problem if the seasonal balance that we've described here is upset by a powerful storm that might, for example, occur only once every 100 years. In that case, recovery of the beach from this exceptional storm may take many years. Erosion also becomes a problem if the beach is regularly exposed to currents that flow along the shoreline, known as longshore currents, particularly if the longshore current flows mostly in the same direction. It can also become a problem with sea level rise and if it interferes with human constructions. Finally, reflective beaches occur under low wave energies. Their formation is also promoted by coarse grained sediments such as gravel and cobbles. Reflective beaches are common on lakes, and beaches along the southern Swedish coast periodically display a steep reflective beach face. Reflective beaches are so named because their steep cross-shore gradients tend to reflect rather than dissipate the low incident wave energies. Reflective sand beaches are highly susceptible to change during storms because the reflected storm wave energy quickly erodes the steeper parts of the beach. The beach becomes flatter and lower as sediment is transported offshore to form bars. We have now covered the key points of this presentation and have tied them together under the concept of beach morphodynamics. We will now apply our knowledge to answering the question of where is it safe to swim? We will do that on the beach we see here. To answer this question, note what you observe of the beach morphology and of the wave breaking. Think also about whether this beach appears to be high, intermediate, or low energy. You can pause the presentation if you like to give you time to make these observations. Some key observations I have made include that the waves are breaking offshore. We know that waves break in shallow water, so it appears that there are sandbars present offshore. I also notice that the breaking wave heights are uneven. There are some places where the breaking waves are small compared with other locations in the photograph. This indicates that there is not a long, continuous sandbar offshore of the beach, but rather short sandbar segments occur. I also notice that the beach face is embayed and that those embayments connect with areas of darker water where breaking wave heights are lower. I interpret these features as indicating locations of rip channels where offshore flowing rip currents occur. These are the areas I would avoid swimming in. But what happens if you get caught in a rip current? What should you do? The important thing is to stay calm and remember that the rip currents are narrow. So rather than trying to swim into shore against the current, swim a few meters to the side to escape the rip and catch a wave to help you swim back into shore. If the beach is patrolled by lifeguards, swim between the flags, and if you get caught in a rip, signal to shore for help. Rip currents are not just a feature of beaches in other countries, but also sometimes occur at selected beaches in southern Sweden. These can sometimes cause problems for swimmers and very rarely deaths. For example, on the 17th of July 2015, two people drowned at Harvang. Don't be alarmed. The risk is low, and the next time you go swimming at a beach in Sweden or elsewhere, you can apply your knowledge of beach morphodynamics to work out where you can swim safely. You are now invited to reflect upon what you have learned. You could, for example, write down your key points to help remember them, or you can repeat the presentation at a later time. You may also wish to read our 2020 report on Kusnara sediment dynamic, which also discusses beach morphodynamics. There are also abundant online resources on beach morphodynamics and beach safety, a few of which are listed here.